let's get together, you know, have lunch and see what happens. I think that kind of undermines the process, and if we have registered lobbyists, I think everything is open to the public. The public knows who you're meeting with, and you know who you're meeting with. So I'm all for it.
Thank you. The next question will be for Mr. Karolian. Several years ago, a $1,000 campaign contribution limit was introduced in Glendale. What impact do you think this limit has had on Glendale elections? Do you think any changes should be made to the contribution limit? Your two-minute response, please.
Thank you. That was back in 2009, if I'm not mistaken. And yes, I even suggested that the amount should be lower than 1,000 because that gives an opportunity for all challengers who may not necessarily have the contacts with developers, contacts with lobbyists, contacts with consultants to be able to raise all those monies that incumbents are or have in their access. As far as impact, I personally, other than being positive, I don't see any negative impact because, again, it gives the opportunity for the challengers to be at least to some level, it still is not equal level, but at least to some degree to be able to get their voice out, be seen, and try to do the best they can to reach out to the community, whether that is through literature or meeting with the public. So on the other hand, though, it limits the potential of any corruption by incumbents. When you have limited funds coming in, definitely there's a limit to each and every special interest group or individual who can contribute to an incumbent, and in that aspect it is a very positive ordinance, and I wished it was less than 1,000.
Thank you. Mr. Drayman, your one-minute response, please.
Well, this part of campaign finance reform came in 2007, and I know because I'm the one that raised it on this city council dais. Our mayor at the time, Ara Najarian, and I were the two on this council that proposed that it be limited to $250, but better to have the legislation than none at all, and we ended up with 1,000. I think it's too soon to know whether it's working and whether it's not working. This is the first complete election cycle the city has seen from start to finish under this new campaign reform. So it's too soon to know. On the positive side, it is limiting the amount of dollars flowing to individual candidates. That's probably a very good thing. On the possible negative side, it is also possible that it is limiting the candidates' opportunities or abilities to get the word out to the community. You'll notice that it's many people don't even know we're having an election, and that's a piece of that as well. But all in all, I think it's too soon to know. We'll make an evaluation, I think, at the end of the cycle.
Mr. Weaver, your one-minute response, please.
At the time it was discussed, I really didn't care if it was 250 or 1,000, because having done six campaigns, I kind of know how do you get the message out without spending money. You have to put out yard signs. You have to send at least one brochure. 80-some thousand registered voters in this city. How do you even remotely get anything to all of them? No candidate can afford to do that. The ones that finish, in all that my elections, I've usually raised less money than the winners. Just tried to be more efficient. But you have the cost of mailing, which could be $10,000-$15,000. Have signs, at least $2,000, and whatever else you do, TV spots, whatever, it all adds up. So where's the money coming from? Meg Whitman did it all with her own money. Governor Brown did what I knew would happen and may happen this campaign. Independent expenditure committees, unknown to the general public, out there raising money. Governor Brown did that, and I wouldn't be surprised to see it happen here.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your one-minute response, please.
I think the limits on financial contributions were right on. I agree with our current mayor, who was in favor of $250 limits. I think that should be the limit. That's the limit in Burbank, I believe. It should be here as well. If you want to reach out and communicate with the public, there's many ways of doing it. You don't have to spend that much money to do it. I've been at both ends of this argument, and I believe that having contribution limits is completely positive, so I'm all for it.
Thank you. Mr. Mohill, your one-minute response, please.
Well, my campaign has been a grassroots campaign. I'm not an incumbent, so I don't have a war chest behind me. All my contributions, none of them have reached $1,000, but friends and family have contributed to me, and I appreciate all the money they have given me. Yard signs and mailers are great if you have the money, and unfortunately, unless you are already an incumbent, people like myself are at a disadvantage. And I would reduce the campaign contribution to $500. And independent committees is something that I'm worried about because the unions haven't started doing their thing yet. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question will be directed to Mr. Drayman. What concrete steps can and should be taken to improve traffic safety in Glendale? Your two-minute response, please.
Well, the first thing we can do is to fully implement our own mobility plan. This city has an excellent mobility plan that was put in place and brought forward before I was elected in 2007. In 2006, they had it in place. We still have not fully implemented that. That would be the first step. That would be my suggestion to begin with. We also need to recognize that we have about 60,000 residents in our city who are residents, I'm calling them in quotes, only from 9 to 5. In other words, they work in our city, commute in by automobile, and then leave our city at the end of the day. And these are people who would like to be, I would like them to be a part, some of them certainly, a part of our population 24/7. We need to get them out of their cars is the long and short of it, and most of them tell us they would love to make Glendale their home, except that we don't have the housing inventory that they desire. By making them stakeholders in our downtown, we improve our downtown by way of their just very being here and demanding better goods, services, a cleaner and safer downtown. But getting people out of their cars, better transit in our downtown, implementing our mobility study, and finally, let's continue what Councilmember Friedman has been discussing with our bicycles. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Weaver, your one-minute response, please.
Well, as an engineer, I think I've tried to look at every form of handling traffic, speeding, whatever, in this city, any city, and I can't figure it out. We all see it. We see people breaking the law all the time, running red lights, trying to cross streets without looking to see if there's an oncoming car, where the car really controls the situation. Cell phones, using cell phones, running red lights, everything. I forecast we ought to have red light cameras in here. LA's made a lot of money out of it. People just don't care. If they're going to break the law, they're going to do it, and no matter what laws you put in, what kind of mechanisms you do, you're not going to succeed. State law and federal law govern to a degree what you're going to do on different streets of different sizes. So there's no magic bullet that's going to solve it. And public education isn't going to work either because people don't listen. They do what they want to do.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your one-minute response, please.
Thank you. I believe public education works. It works every time. If it saves one individual from driving fast, I think it's worth it. I think it has to be a two-pronged approach, enforcement and education. Education being first in on either TV, GTV6 or in the papers, talking about speeding and reckless driving and the results of those two. We also need to measure the traffic infractions, the citations that are issued, where they're issued and why they're issued. And we also have to do enforcement actions where in certain areas we can go on for a few months and issue warning citations, not citations, just to let people know that what they're doing is not right, so that they change their behavior. And the key to the enforcement action is continuous enforcement, not on a on a daily basis, but not letting up after a couple of months, actually issuing citations and then going back
every
months and continuing
Thank
with
you.
That.
Mr. Mohill, your one-minute response, please.
Help to improve traffic safety. More policemen for law enforcement would be a benefit. More public education. Synchronizing our lights in the downtown area. Telecommuting would encourage more people to work at home and not spend their time on the roads. Those are the main things I would do. And also try and create more affordable housing in the downtown area.
Thank you. Mr. Karolian, your one-minute response, please.
We need to get people out of their cars first, but at the same time, we need to reach out and educate the community, educate every single individual who comes to work in Glendale, who drives by Glendale, or who comes to make this as his or her permanent residence. In addition to education, we need to enforce the law, and we have to be very strict about enforcing the law. There was a time when I was on law enforcement, I do remember that people came to Glendale and they behaved. They knew that you violate any law, you don't make a full stop, you do get a citation. And now in addition to rolling stops, people are on their cell phones, texting, calling, and not paying attention to any pedestrian, to any traffic laws, and apparently they're getting by. So enforcement has to be very strict. We need to get back to the idea that you come to Glendale, you don't violate the laws here.
Thank you. The next question will be to Mr. Weaver. We have another traffic question. Traffic gridlock is a growing problem in Glendale. What solutions would you propose?
Well, as I just said, I haven't the foggiest. People keep talking about synchronization of lights. That is not a cheap, inexpensive solution. It's costly and it'll take time. To show you, I said this in a previous forum, during the December when I was decorating the Rose Float, I had occasion to be over Northwest Glendale at 5:36 in the morning, far Northwest Glendale. I drove from there clear through Glendale to the Eagle Rock border and did not hit one red light in the entire time. Why? There was nobody on the road. I just went through. When you double the population of this city, during the workday hours, and they're all coming at one time and all leaving at one time, you get gridlock on all the freeways. The freeways are gridlock. How are you going to solve that problem? You can go to a game at the Rose Bowl or the Coliseum. You can drive around it anytime. You can jog around it. But when there's a game, gridlock. How you can cut down those peaks, I hear, well, people will get on their bicycles, right? Yeah, when it's pouring rain, they'll ride a bicycle, right? When it's hot, will they ride a bicycle? Maybe they won't. But to come up with a solution, the mobility plan is going to be the best thing that we can do to try to manipulate the traffic flow downtown. Synchronization is great, but there's no magic bullet out there that is going to do that for this city or for any city. We've grown so much. I've lived here all my life. And with the amount of traffic now, with the number of people, that each year there's more speeders, more people running through the city that don't give a darn about any rules. I just hope this mobility plan will take us another step. Discuss it at council more than one time, and we'll be doing it again. But I'm not holding my breath. We're going to stop.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your one-minute response, please.
Thank you. I do believe that working with businesses and changing traffic and transportation habits of the employees would certainly work, go a long way in addressing traffic concerns. Having employers encourage employees to come to work an hour early or leave an hour later and starting their work day maybe an hour later or a couple hours later. I don't get on downtown streets in Glendale before 10 o'clock and after 4 o'clock, so I try to avoid those hours, and that's what people should try to do. I would also encourage employers to encourage their employees to telecommute. I think that's the best way to address some of these traffic concerns. If half your employees are telecommuting half the week, I think we can certainly cut down on the number of auto trips that are being taken on the streets of our city. So those are two of the ways that I would suggest.
Mr. Mohill, your one-minute response, please.
I wrote five things down to help us in that situation. First would be synchronized lighting. Two, stagger the working hours of employees who work in Glendale. Telecommuting, more people working a four-day week, and more law enforcement for traffic. And where we can get the money from traffic, law enforcement, pensions of over $150,000 does not buy a cop, a policeman to do law enforcement and help in the traffic. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Karolian, your one-minute response, please.
I've taken down some notes here. Implementing mobility plan would be the first. As I said, as part of the answer to my previous question, we need to get people out of their vehicles. Carpooling should be encouraged, and we can start that with the city employees right here. And, of course, telecommuting is another option. As to synchronization of lights, I would like to invite Mr. Weaver to the corner of or intersection of Adams and Broadway. You can stay in that at that light for approximately a minute and a half, and it doesn't change, and there's no one crossing that intersection. So probably the traffic engineering should do something about that at least. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Drayman, your one-minute response, please.
That may be where our missing candidate is, stuck at that corner. When I grew up in Glendale, Glendale was a bedroom community, and it is no longer a bedroom community. We're now the third largest city in the county, and whether we like it or not, we've become a more urbanized city with all of the problems that come with a more urbanized city. And perhaps along the way, we have not taken the steps necessary to anticipate that growth. But here we are. So to some degree, you're not going to eliminate traffic and gridlock. You've heard some examples mentioned. Again, I'll come back to our mobility plan. I hope that we can implement that fully. But there are other things that we can do, like working with developers of projects to make sure that when they're building a project, they include, for example, turn lanes on the project site itself to get traffic out of the flow, and so on. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question will be directed to Mr. Manoukian. Besides campaign contribution limits, are there other aspects of campaign finance reform which should be considered by the City Council? Your two-minute response, please.
Thank you. Well, the suggestion I made notes here, the suggestion made by Mr. Mike Mohill, is certainly one of them, and that's the independent expenditures limit. I believe that implementing the campaign finance reforms and having the contribution limits to 1,000 for individuals and then allowing independent expenditures that can spend up as much as they want, actually, on for or against the candidate does not achieve the purpose that the campaign finance reform was implemented. So I'm completely opposed. I'm completely in favor of I'm opposed to independent expenditures against candidates of thousands of dollars, but I'm in favor of limiting as well the independent expenditures. So I think that's the road that we should follow. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mohill. Your one-minute response, please.
Well, again, I would keep the amount of campaign money under $500. The issue of independent committees, I understand that we can't change that because it's a state law. As much as the non-incumbents would like that, we can't change that. But I think we should make public to the public knowing that who are these people who are making these independent committees. In the past, it always seems to be the safety people in the city of Glendale who always have their slate mailers, vote for these three or two people because there are people, please vote for them. It should be interesting what they will do this year. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Karolian, your one-minute response, please.
I would like to see some limitations on independent expenditure groups. However, though, as Mr. Mohill said, that is not within the jurisdiction of a municipality. Other than the reform that has been done here, again, as I said earlier, I would have liked it to see within the limits of $500 instead of $1,000. I think the only thing we expect, not as far as financing or raising funds or contribution, we expect some decency, some integrity, some honesty, some transparency by the candidates themselves. aside from where the money is coming from, as to what exactly they are doing or what is being done for them through that money is more concerning to me than actual organizations funding campaigns.
Thank you. Mr. Drayman, your one-minute response, please.
Thank you. We do a number of things, such as we now limit the amount of time that a candidate can raise funds. It's now limited to 180 days on either side of the election. That never existed before, and, of course, the $1,000 limit. And in addition to that, we can't roll war chests over. We have to spend down funds that are in our office holder account to below $10,000. That is also something new for this complete election cycle. Independent expenditures have been mentioned. The courts have ruled that that's considered protected speech, so there's nothing we can do about that. It's an evil that exists that we don't have control over. But I agree that also with one other thing, the news press has suggested databases of contributors that work on city-subsidized projects, because currently council has no way of knowing, candidates have no way of knowing, and our city keeps no record of that currently.
Thank you. Mr. Weaver, your one-minute response, please.
Well, I guess I'm the one that started with the independent expenditures. I mean, because I know Governor Brown did it extensively, perfectly legal. It's independent because the candidate doesn't know what's happening. Any of us get the mailer. I don't know. It may say on there who did it, Citizens for Joe Blow. But you don't know. I guess there's a way to find out, but I haven't the foggiest. And you're not going to find out before the election, even if it does. The finance reform, I don't know what more we can do. More forums like this on TV, I think, would be great. Or just having this is the only one that's on TV, and we're doing 12, 13 forums with seven more to go. Why aren't more on TV hearing more from our residents what they like? That's one way to get the message out that we can't get it out now. If you don't want mailers to go out and you don't want signs going up, then you better put us on TV so the people know there is an election and have a choice to hear what we think.
Thank you. The next question will be directed to Mr. Mohill. What do you consider as the most important environmental issues facing Glendale? Your two-minute response, please.
We have a couple issues, environmental issues. We have pollution still, bad air. We have water conservation. We need to recycle our water so we can make it last longer. We're going to do 3 days a week, so I don't know how long. That's all I can think of at this moment.
Thank you. Mr. Karolian, your one-minute response, please.
Pollution is one, obviously, and we have, I believe, we have talked about traffic congestion, and reducing traffic would help in reducing smog and pollution. The second would be the water crisis. Recycling water is one thing that we have to follow aggressively. Saving water is another thing that, especially within communities and neighborhoods where we have the most congested families and communities, we are not, as far as the city, we are not educating these individuals and these families on ways of saving water or recycling water. That there has to be a huge outreach program for that. And the third one is conserving energy. I do see once in a while that notes are being sent by the Water and Power, but...
Thank you. Mr. Drayman, your one-minute response, please.
I think the largest challenge right now, as I see it, is the potential of contamination of groundwater. And I say potential, it's a concern. In our San Fernando corridor, San Fernando Road corridor, this is from contamination during the 50s in the aerospace industry, and that plume has crept down into Glendale as well. So continued concern there for that cleanup. Also, though, this council has created a very forward-looking anti-smoking ordinance or clean air ordinance. We have new Cal Green ordinances that we have implemented, and, of course, our water conservation. These are all winners.
Thank you. Mr. Weaver, your one-minute response, please.
See, we're dealing with Chromium 6 issues. We have the first plant in the United States that is dealing with that issue. Storm drain diversion, we're not allowed to allow cigarette butts, et cetera, to go into the LA River. We're having to catch those at the storm drain inlets. Our buses, we've converted many of them to CNG, natural gas. Bob Hope Airport Authority that I'm on is doing the same thing. We did, one was shown today at the commission meeting where we've converted one and we'll be converting all the others. And yes, the plume, it's at the airport. There's a lawsuit going on about that now. And with Lockheed, and that plume was moving this way. And we will have to deal with Chromium 6 and other issues probably for decades to come.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your one-minute response, please.
I was the only council member while on council to insist on lower chromium-6 levels in our water. All the council members at that time were okay with having 50 parts per billion chromium-6 into your water, into your children's water. And I was the only one who insisted on a report that said 6 parts per billion was not acceptable. And I insisted to have our water to be less than 6 parts per billion. What you should be asking today from your council members is what is the chromium level in our water today? And I believe it has changed and it's not public. That should be public. The second issue that is of an environmental concern is our Shoal Canyon landfill. If you can't throw your trash away, I wonder what the city would look like. So that's coming up as well. We should be looking to that.
Thank you. The next question will be directed to Mr. Karolian. Should the City of Glendale have a code of ethics that applies to both employees and council members? Your two-minute response, please.
Should the city have a code of ethics? Of course. And to begin with, there used to be one years before. As of today, I don't know if there is one for the city employees. However, though, I've seen and witnessed incidents where citizens are treated in a way that I'm sure the employees would not have accepted if they were treated the same way. The lack of respect towards the community that we serve, that the city employees serve, the lack of respect by council members towards the community that they are elected to serve is obviously an indication that there has to be a code of ethics, and it is already, well, time has passed on that, but hopefully we can talk about this more openly and discuss it and eventually come to some kind of an ordinance which enforces people treat others with respect, whether they are council members or they're just city employees serving in this community. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Drayman, your one-minute response, please.
Well, the short answer is yes. This would benefit both elected officials and the public as well. And one important element of this, I hope, will be that, again, a database of those who work on or are involved with projects that are city-subsidized projects. Currently, there is no such database. There's no such information readily available from our city attorney without them going to the outside somewhere. So I hope that will be created. That was suggested by the Glendale News Press, and I hope that comes about. Also, our mayor, current mayor, Mayor Najarian, has been sponsoring this, and that will be coming forward.
Thank you. Mr. Weaver, your one-minute response, please.
I was going to say the same thing. It's on the council agenda shortly. Watch those, Mr. LC, just touch it. I personally think that everybody has their own set of ethical values. You learn it, you learn along the way. And many people make excuses for their own behavior, which they say is their set of ethics. So how you set down one set of standards that you can enforce and make everybody operate the same way, I think, is almost impossible. So you can have a set of ethics rules, but then how do you manage and control it? It sounds nice, but everybody is different.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your one-minute response, please.
Could you repeat the question,
sure,
please?
Should the City of Glendale have a code of ethics that applies to both employees and council members?
Absolutely. I think the City of Glendale should have a code of ethics. I think we should be legislating morality. It's important because it's apparent that we can't abide by ethics on our own. It shouldn't just be to the employees. It should be actually applied to the managers, executives, and up to everyone. The question that comes to mind, however, is whether I won't go there, but that's enough.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Mohill, your one-minute response, please.
Well, ethics. That is one of our biggest problems right now in this campaign, the public trust. Mr. Weaver was fined $9,000 for money laundering in 2009, and here is the evidence right here, public document.
Ma'am, I thought there was going to be no personal stuff in here.
It's public record.
Have another incumbent who has been under investigation by ADI for having a home remodel in their condo. And then he won't tell the public, but he goes ahead and approves their millions of dollars in housing projects. The public trust has been lost in this election, and I'd like to restore it. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question will be directed to Mr. Draymond. What do you believe the City Council could do to improve their relationship with the Glendale Board of Education? Your two-minute response, please.
Great question. Let me start by telling you why that relationship is so important. When you're an elected official in this city, and even if you're not, you recognize very quickly that the main reason people come to Glendale in the first place is our Glendale schools, and in particular our primaries. That is the reason. That is the major attraction for people to come here, buy homes, to rent here, and live here, and become stakeholders in our city. When I joined the council in 2007, we didn't have an elected official, a council member, who was willing to sit with our Glendale Unified School District partners. I volunteered to be that person. I have been the council liaison ever since. As a result, we have had joint meetings, joint projects, joint building projects, joint publications, assisted with all manners of the projects with the school district. I think their determination is that we are much closer as organizations now. We coordinate much better now, and yes, it is very important, and I hope to continue doing that.
Thank you. Mr. Weaver, your one-minute response, please.
Well, I hate to disappoint Mr. Draymond, but years before he was on the council, I was the liaison to the school district, and to be very honest, I didn't continue to stay on there. Why? I went there even as mayor. I would sit there and I was totally ignored. The guy they wanted to talk to was the city manager. And after sitting there and not being asked to participate, I said, heck, no need for me to be here. They got the person they want. But we've had a lot more efforts, relationships with the school district on synthetic turf fields, on Pacific Edison Park, other school facilities. We've had a lot of good relationships. And just because it seems a little strained now because of something called magnet schools in Northwest Glendale doesn't mean we don't have a very good working relationship. I know the superintendent, the vice superintendent, I know most of the principals in the schools. So I think we have a very good relationship.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your one-minute response, please.
Thank you. I just want to clarify what I was going to say before. I was going to say code of ethics for some of the members of the public. I wasn't going to refer to any of the incumbents or anything like that, just so we're clear. As far as working with our colleagues in the public schools as well as the college, I think it's important for any council member or anyone in the community who is capable of helping the schools, helping the city to work together to achieve what we must achieve for our children. And that is the most important thing. And we should look beyond our personal beliefs. We should look beyond our personal fears, and we should work together to help the community, to help the children. We've done that before. We've helped fund the Glendale High School artificial turf field. We've helped fund a number of other elementary schools where we had green spaces instead of asphalt. As a council member, I voted for those, and I strongly believe that working together, we can achieve anything.
Thank you. Mr. Mohill, your one-minute response, please.
We can talk about nice things like we're going to work with the Board of Education as council members, but I think what they want is some concrete doings. For example, why can't we reduce the utilities they pay, like water and electricity? They do that in Los Angeles. But of course, we need the money here in Glendale. That's why this city council won't reduce their fees. We have the highest utilities among the four cities around us. I don't blame the schools not wanting to talk with city council. What have they done for them? Thank you. It's all about money.
Mr. Karolian, your one-minute response, please.
I do realize that in the past there have been some attempts to improve relationships with the school district, whether it's the organization or principals or the superintendent. However, though, for me to measure success and to see whether those contacts or meetings or relationships have been successful would have been to see school fields actually opened and available to the communities where they're located. Unfortunately, I have not seen that. Someone has to take the leadership, and I believe the city council has to do that, has to take the first step in encouraging schools to open their fields for youth who live in that same community. So instead of taking the wrong route and getting involved in drugs and gangs, our youth will be able to play on those fields, especially that we don't have soccer fields primarily in South Glendale neighborhoods.
Thank you. We will now begin the candidates' closing statements, and we're going to go in reverse ballot order. And we'll begin with Mr. Draymond. Your closing statement, please.
Well, thank you. Thanks to the League again. 4 years ago, with your support and the support of a very professional city council, we were able to innovate a positive path forward for the residents of this city. And with your help, I was able to complete a reform of our city's design review and appeal process. I was able to move our design review meetings to the evenings when our residents could attend. I sponsored the archiving of all of our city meetings on our website so that you can watch them at whenever you wish. I was able to bring about a complete reform of our city's appointment process for board and commission members. No longer can a single council member pack a board or commission with two and three commission members. I sponsored the effort to remove cell phone towers from our residential neighborhoods. I successfully led the effort to save Chevy Chase Branch Library. I brought the Museum of Neon Art, MONA, from Los Angeles to Glendale, our first downtown museum, when it arrives. I created Glendale's Community Garden Program. I brought Glendale a new arts and entertainment district with Lemley Theaters as the anchor. I advocated for historic districting before I was elected, and I'm proud to say that once I arrived here as an elected official, I was able to support it from the dais. And if you happen to live in the Crescenta Valley, and I know there's some looking in right now, I brought Trader Joe's to Montrose. I brought design guidelines to the Foothill Corridor for the first time ever to protect the integrity of the Crescenta Valley. I brought the Sunday Harvest Market to Montrose. I made the preservation of Mountain Oaks as undeveloped open space my personal commitment. And I sponsored the preservation of historic Rockhaven Sanitarium as the future home of the Montrose Branch Library. Ladies and gentlemen, if you care about your city, if you care about your quality of life, if you care that you have a voice in the decisions that affect you and your family, I ask you to please vote for me for re-election, John Draymond, on April 5th. You won't make a better investment in your city's future. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Karelian, your two-minute closing statement, please.
Thank you. Tonight you've been more knowledgeable of the problems facing Glendale, and now you need to decide if this time you truly want a new direction. With the incumbents, we'll continue to have budget deficits supported by borrowing, and pension reform will not be addressed. With the incumbents, small business will continue to lose to national chains. With the incumbents, only some areas of Glendale will get proper planning, and property rights will continue to be secondary to connected developers. I pledge to you that I will support property rights as one of the most essential rights of our democracy. I will make sure that the needs of small businesses become an important part of city planning and policy. I will maintain the character of our neighborhoods and preserve historic nature of this city. I will do my best to support our natural resources, clean available water, clean air, renewable energy, and the maintenance of our green space. I promise to be prudent with our tax dollars and will strive to make Glendale the safest mid-sized city in America once again. I can assure you of this. I will serve the interests of all neighborhoods and residents. I will use one measure to decide our expenditures and policies, and that is, how will they improve our quality of life? This year, more than any other, you have clear choices to make. My name is Shahe Karolian, and I'll champion the taxpayers' and ratepayers' rights first. I ask you for your vote of confidence coming April 5th. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Mohill, your two-minute closing statement, please.
3 years ago, the Indigenous Tree Ordinance brought me to City Hall one night, and I stayed to witness how our local government really worked. What I saw was the City Council's need to pass additional fees for trash, water, electricity, permit fees, impact fees, and on and on. At every corner, staff would come before the City Council and recommend increases in fees and utility rates to support a growing and bloated budget. This approach for managing our city has impacted our quality of life. We must find better ways to manage our city. A city budget of over $800 million is not acceptable. A city debt of hundreds of millions of dollars is not acceptable. And a city pension obligation of over $1 billion is not acceptable either. We must make tough decisions. Our problems are not in the revenue side of budgeting, ladies and gentlemen, but is on the expense side. City departments must take serious steps in looking for ways to reduce expenses. The number of city managers at all levels must be reduced. $16 billion in workman compensation claims will no longer be acceptable. Impact fees must be reduced or eliminated. Overtime pay needs to be controlled. Glendale must really become known as a business-friendly, and the cost of government on our families must be reduced. A brighter future for the corner of our life and your support will make Glendale a better place to be. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mike Mohill, running for Glendale City Council.
Thank you. Mr. Manoukian, your two-minute closing statement, please.
Thank you. I would like to thank the League of Women Voters for organizing this forum. I would like to thank everyone who's here again and who is watching from home. I would like to address one issue regarding the public. I think it's important to start the budget process now, not after the election. And as far as my closing remark, I would like you to ask yourself, are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? Are the costs to provide your utilities under control? Are you paying more for your water during recessionary times? Is the council today transparent in conducting the affairs of the people? Are you concerned that our city is being financially mismanaged? Now is the time to make a choice for change. While I was on council, I was the only council member who had sidewalk office hours where community members could stop by and address their concerns. When elected, I will have my calendar public so everyone can see who I'm meeting with. I will also have all documentation regarding the city, staff, and the public, meaning, and the public, in the public domain, meaning on the web. It's time to reintroduce public service to our local government. I respectfully ask for your vote and thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Mr. Weaver, your two-minute closing statement, please.
I'm very sorry that it had to get personal here again tonight, like it does in every single forum. Only eight more to go to listen to that. One thing that I think everybody should know at home, there's a concerted effort by some candidates to keep this election extremely quiet. I've been asked many times, what election? It's been an attempt to do that. And I'm trying to tell you, get out and vote. Tell your neighbors to vote. It's very important. This is a democracy. You have a right to vote. Exercise it. Now, some things that haven't been touched on here tonight, I throw out. Yes, we have a balanced budget. In our general fund alone, we have a $50 million reserve account. We have over $1.1 billion in assets in this city. On salary and benefits, the employee pays 9% of their own plus 2% of the employer's. We're the only city in this neighborhood, maybe in Southern California, that does that, and we have now instituted a two-tier system. Only 21 cities in the state have a two-tier system. 480 don't. We're one of the 20. Electrical rates, the LA Department of Water and Power did a study, and it shows Glendale's right in the middle of all the rates. I don't care to listen to Mr. Mulhill's rates. I'd rather listen to the professionals at the Department of Water and Power that says we're right in the middle on our rate structures, and that has been presented to the City Council. I want to repeat, we are a good city. We've got 540 acres of open space now in Glendale, historic districts, the Americana, five new mini parks, a smoking ordinance, new projects being constructed. I firmly believe my major responsibilities are to keep the city fiscally sound, which it is, provide good services at reasonable costs, make sound decisions for the greater good of the city, and I will continue you to do that if you will leave it to Weaver, and I'm number one on your ballot. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes our forum. Our thanks to the candidates who are willing to step forward to serve the public. Many complain, but very few are willing to get out there and work. The League would also like to thank both our audience in attendance and those of you at home. Please be sure to go to the polls on April 5th or to mail in and drop off your ballot so that it is received by April 5th. If you have any questions at all about the election, go to glendalevotes.org, which is the official Glendale Elections website. It has everything that you need to know about the election in order to make an informed choice. Thank you very much, and good night.
En los próximos días estará recibiendo su boleta de muestra y aplicación de voto por correo de parte de la oficina del secretario. Si usted opta a votar por correo, por favor complete la forma que está en la parte trasera de su boleta de muestra. Imprima su nombre, dirección, fecha y su firma y coloque un sello para ser enviado de nuevo a la oficina del secretario. En algunas semanas recibirá su boleto por correo y podrá votar desde la comodidad de su casa. Si usted ha perdido su boleta de muestra con la aplicación o si no ha recibido una, puede llamar.
You don't want to miss our next episode of NSTV right here on GTV6.
Take a tour of Shoal Canyon Landfill with some of our middle school junior ambassadors. Find out who was named Glendale's Volunteer of the Year and more.
Check your local listings for showtimes or visit the GTV6 website at www.glendale.tv. See you then.
I vote because I want my kids to play in a safe neighborhood.
I vote because I want a clean environment.
I vote because I care about our schools.
I vote because I believe in public safety.
I vote because I care about the economy.
I vote because this is my first election.
I vote because it's my civic duty.
There are many reasons to vote, but not a single reason why you shouldn't. A message from the City Clerk Elections Division.
Do you have prescription medication painkillers in your home? Do you know where they are? Do you know if they're all still there? The theft of pharmaceuticals from homes has jumped at an alarming rate. They're stolen by strangers and guests welcomed into our homes and even our own family members. They get abused by drug addicts, misused by others, and sold individually in our schools, our businesses, and on the street. Recent emergency room visits linked to prescription painkillers has increased 111%. In fact, admission to drug rehab facilities has increased 400%. Often the drugs used by our younger population and addicted adults aren't being sold by a stranger or some scary drug dealer. They're both stolen and sold directly from our own medicine cabinets. Ensure your medication is secured in your household and any unused or old medications are disposed of properly. Never dispose of medication in the sink, toilet, or trash. While medicine is good for what ails you, it's important to dispose of medication properly. Departments within the City of Glendale, such as the Public Works Department, the Glendale Fire Department, and the Glendale Police Department, are working together to educate and assist you in the proper disposal of your old and unneeded medication. Just bring them into the Glendale Environmental Management Center at 780 Flower Street on Wednesdays and Saturdays between the hours of 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. For more information, please call 818-548-3900. The City of Glendale thanks you for your help in fighting drug abuse in our community and protecting our environment from discarded pharmaceuticals.
Welcome to the Look Ahead. Let's see what meetings and events are happening in our city in the upcoming week. A schedule of city meetings with live air and replay times can be found on the GTV6 website, www.glendale.tv, and on the bulletin board airing daily on GTV6. Please be aware that some of these meetings may be canceled or postponed after the original posting. If you're in doubt, call the department responsible for the meeting. Now let's see what's coming up. An orienteering class will be held at Duke Majan Wilderness Park on Saturday, March 12th. This is a great learning session for people who like to get out in the wild. Call the Park Naturalists at 818-548-3775 for the time and location. And over at the Chevy Chase Branch Library, JPL scientist George Vasquez will discuss NASA's Aquarius program, a satellite mission to measure the salt content of the ocean from space, to learn more about its effect on water and the global climate. This mission is being developed by NASA and the Space Agency of Argentina. The event begins at 3 p.m. Details are available at 818-548-2046. On Sunday, March 13th, Glendale's Downtown Dash returns to Brand Boulevard. Registration takes place at 7 a.m. in front of the Alex Theater for this 5K run. A youth run is also being offered for those under 13 years of age. All proceeds benefit stroke research and programs in Glendale. Call 818-409-8100 if you have questions. The Glendale Commission on the Status of Women will meet at 5:30 p.m. on Monday, March 14th in City Council Chambers. Call Christine Baboumian at 818-548-4844 if you want more information. If you are a senior puzzling over the new federal income tax laws, you can get free assistance at the Spar Heights Community Center on Mondays and Tuesdays during the months of March and April. AARP members will provide this help between 12:30 and 4:30 p.m. Be sure to bring last year's return and any tax-related documents you may have received. The service is free, but reservations must be made in advance with Shirley Robertson at 818-548-2188. We'll be right back after this quick break.
Did you know Glendale alone we investigated 6 traffic-related deaths last year? The majority of these incidents involved pedestrians hitting crosswalks. Through engineering, education, and enforcement, the City of Glendale wants to inform the public of the dangers of distracted driving and to encourage vigilance while crossing the street. If you're driving, don't be driven to distraction. And if you're walking, look to live.
I vote because I want my kids to play in a safe neighborhood.
I vote because I want a clean environment.
I vote because I care about our schools.
I vote because I believe in public safety.
I vote because I care about the economy.
I vote because this is my first election.
I vote because it's my civic duty.
There are many reasons to vote, but not a single reason why you shouldn't. A message from the City Clerk Elections Division.
you have graffiti on your property? Glendale Municipal Code requires that property owners remove graffiti within 10 days. The city's Neighborhood Services Division offers property owners a convenient graffiti removal service for a minimal cost. Our one-time removal fee ranges from $50 to $150, depending on the square footage of the graffiti. For $250, Neighborhood Services will remove graffiti from your property for an entire year. With our new state-of-the-art graffiti removal trucks equipped with paint sprayers, environmentally friendly solvents, and high-powered pressure washers, we are sure to safely remove graffiti from almost any surface, including unpainted natural surfaces. You can spare yourself the aggravation and effort of removing graffiti from your property by calling Neighborhood Services at 818-548-3700 between 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. or after business hours on our graffiti removal hotline at 818-548-3726. Proceeds from this program will cover the cost of graffiti removal materials and are used to fund graffiti prevention programs. For Neighborhood Services, I'm Jakeson Webb.
Welcome back. On Tuesday, March 15th, the Housing Authority and the Redevelopment Agency will meet consecutively at 2:30 p.m. in City Council chambers. At or about the same time, there will be a joint public meeting of the City Council and the Redevelopment Agency to discuss the following: the courtyard by Marriott's property development at 225 West Wilson, and evaluation of sustainable construction practices under Cal Green, plus a consideration of a citywide sustainability coordinator. The regular meeting of the City Council takes place at 6 p.m. To obtain more information about the Housing Authority, call 818-548-2060. The number of the Redevelopment Agency is 818-548-2005. And for City Council business, call 818-548-4844. The Community Police Partnership Advisory Committee will meet at noon in the Police Community Room on Wednesday, March 16th. Details are available at 818-548-4825. The Planning Commission will meet at 5 p.m. in Room 105 of the Municipal Services Building. The telephone number of that commission is 818-548-2140. Please note, both the Glendale Planning Hearing Officer and the monthly meeting of the Building Fire Board of Appeals have been canceled on this date. Community seniors are invited to help celebrate St. Patrick's Day on Thursday, March 17th. Visit the Adult Recreation Center or Spar Heights Community Center for a traditional Irish feast, and don't forget to wear green. The Arts and Culture Commission will meet Thursday, March 17th at 2 p.m. in City Council Chambers. Call 818-548-2000 if you have questions. Design Review Board Number 2 will meet at 5 p.m. in Room 105 of the Municipal Services Building. The information number of DRB is 818-548-2140. That evening, the Friends of the Glendale Library is hosting local author Susan Strait, who will discuss her book, Take One Candle, Light a Room. The event begins at 7 p.m. in the auditorium of the Central Library. Call 818-548-2042 if you have questions. Wednesday, March 16th is the deadline to enroll your children in the Spar Heights Parents Night Out event, to be held Friday, March 18th. The children will play games, watch movies, and eat snacks, supervised by recreation staff, while their parents have a kid-free date. Kids must be potty trained and picked up by 11 p.m., or a late fee will be charged. More details are available from Fabiola Guzman at 818-548-2187. The city is currently seeking sponsorships for two special events that are taking place in the next few weeks. If you would like to offer assistance with the Man's Inhumanity to Man event on April 17th or the Armenian Genocide Commemoration on April 25th, please contact Zizette Mullins at 818-548-4844. And don't forget, the City of Glendale's municipal elections take place on Tuesday, April 5th. For more information, visit glendalevotes.org or call 818-548-4000. That's it for this time. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week.
Here I lay all alone, toss and turning, longing for some of your tender love. I'm waiting for the right moment to come, so I can thank you for
all the tender love you've given to me.
Tender love,
tender love,
love so tender,
love.
Holding me close to you, baby, I surrender. Candles, they light the dark. Now I see how lovely these feelings are.
All the tender love you've given to me,
lady. You more and more, can't resist it more than I feel your touch. Ooh, tender love, loving me straight from the heart. Hold me near, please let me be a part.
Tender love,
love so much.